Unfortunately, I have never met the judge in person. I arrived in Pisa only in 1997, so I cannot share with you any memories of him. However, of course, I mean, it goes without saying that his research had a tremendous impact in the kind of math that I did. I studied both as undergraduate and as graduate students under the supervision of Luigi Ambrosio, and through him I got the possibility of at least grasping something of what was the George's, I mean, tremendous contribution to math. And in fact, in some sense, some tales of what he did is also, I mean, has also a very important impact in this business about spaces with low Ricci curvature bound, and I hope, I mean, I will be able to let you grasp some key points. So what are spaces with low Ricci curvature bounds? So this has been my main topic of research in the last few years, and it is a very, very rapidly growing field of mathematics, which makes it very exciting to work in. So if you work on a field which is rapidly expanding every year, you sort of look back and realize how much more you know about the subject than you did 1 year before, which is great. On the other hand, it makes it harder to communicate with, say, non-specialists about the kind of research, because if you tell sort of the latest news to someone who, I mean, doesn't work on the field, he cannot grasp, I mean, why such a result is important and how it fits into the general theory. So I thought for the talk of today of not really focusing on the latest news in some sense, but sort of take the opportunity to give a brief overview on the subject. So I'm afraid that for those of you who are already, I mean, somehow in touch with the field, I mean, you will be, I mean, a bit bored at the end of the talk. But hopefully, at least for the others, something can be taken. Let me start. Very broadly and naively speaking, the study of spaces with synthetic lower bound on the Ricci curvature, I mean, if I had to fit into the general framework of math, this goes in the setting of completion or compactification of some class of spaces. So this is something that is very common, a very common practice in math. You have some nice smooth object, and for some reason you are interested in taking limits of some of these kind of smooth objects under some kind of weak topology through which the smoothness is not preserved, and so you end up dealing with no smooth guys. I mean, in analysis, this is what, I mean, the raison d'etre in some sense of the notion of Sobolev space. So you are interested in the Dirichlet energy and on smooth function that is clear what it is, but maybe, I mean, you want to pass to the limit to obtain some existence result and then a posteriori regularity result. And so you have to introduce the space of Sobolev functions. And if you leave the field of say functions and you replace function with Riemannian manifold with some lower curvature or upper curvature bound, this is basically the plan of Gromov. So Gromov said, if we are interested in studying a Riemannian manifold with some curvature bound of some kind, then maybe we should also consider the class of limits of Riemannian manifolds with this lower curvature bound or upper curvature bound with respect to some relevant topology. Now here I try to sort of make the most complete picture to date. So if the kind of curvature bound that you're interested in is sectional curvature bound, then it turns out that the relevant topology with respect to which one should consider convergence is the so-called Gromov-Hausdorff convergence. And coupled with Gromov-Hausdorff convergence and sectional curvature bound, there is the notion of Alexandrov spaces. So for those of you who have been here a couple of days ago, one day ago for in the talk of Stefan Wenger, this subject has been mentioned in the sense of cut zero or cut K spaces. So these are spaces with upper sectional curvature bound. The topic of the talk, anyway, will not be really Alexandrov spaces, but perhaps the second line, so bounds from below on the Ricci curvature, for which the relevant topology is the so-called measure of Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, and I will recall in a second what this is. And we do have a notion of abstract metric measure space for which it makes sense to say that the Ricci curvature is bounded from below by K, and actually also the dimension above by N. For what concerns scalar curvature, I mean, little to nothing is known. There is some recent paper by Wengen and Sormani where the notion of intrinsic flat convergence has been sort of used in connection with non-negative scalar, but so the non-smooth side of non-negative scalar is really something which is not understood, and actually would be good to explore this topic further. Just as last word, why for sectional curvature we consider bounds from below and from above, while for Ricci or scalar just from below? Well, the point is that it is known after works of Gao, Yao, Brooks, and Lecamp that upper Ricci curvature bound gives in dimension 3 or more gives no information about the topology of a manifold. So theorem: every closed manifold of dimension 3 and above carries a metric with Ricci less or equal to -1 everywhere. If you think to the case of, well, the manifold is S3, which, I mean, looks round, the fact that on S3 there is a metric with negative Ricci is sort of non-trivial. And the fact that, I mean, so in particular, an upper bound on the Ricci curvature per se that cannot produce any sort of topological implication about the structure of the manifold. So we will only consider lower bound on the Ricci curvature. So very quickly, what is measure Gromov-Hausdorff convergence? Well, I shall give the definition for compact spaces. Then with minor modification, this works for, can be generalized to non-compact ones. So let's say that you have a sequence of spaces, all of which are compact, and let's also say normalized. So the reference measure, the reference measures are probability measures. Then we say that these spaces converge in the measure Gromov-Hausdorff sense to a limit space, provided we can find one big space Y, on which all of these spaces embed isometrically, and in such a way that if you sort of bring the measure with you in this embedding, so you take the push forward of the reference measures with respect to the, I mean, corresponding embedding, well, this measure weakly converges to the limit measure. Okay? And the part of the relevance of this convergence lies in the Gromov's precompactness theorem. So pick your preferred three numbers, K, N, and D, and consider the class of Riemannian manifolds with Ricci curvature bounded from below by K, dimension bounded from above by N, and the diameter bounded from above by your third constant D. Well, then this class of manifold is precompact in the measured Gromov-Hausdorff topology. Okay. So the measure Gromov-Hausdorff topology is our weak topology with respect to which we have some compactness result, and it would be interesting so to know what are the limits of Riemannian manifolds. So how can we characterize the limits of Riemannian manifolds under this convergence? And also, any space which arises as a limit of a sequence of Riemannian manifolds with this Ricci curvature bound is, by definition, also a metric measure space. And a natural question which pops out is, okay, but if I'm given a metric measure space, is there any way I can say, I mean, without knowing that it is limit of Riemannian manifolds, is there any way that I can say that this space has some lower bound on the Ricci curvature in some weak sense? And the answer is yes. And here the breakthrough is a theorem by Sturm and Bohr and S, which has been inspired and motivated by earlier works by Otto Villani and by Cordero, Raskin, McCann, and Schmucke-Schlager. And the theorem goes like this. This is a pretty famous theorem. Maybe many of you already heard about it. So pick a compact Riemannian manifold. I don't want to. I mean, they will. Technical complication, and then the Ricci curvature of this Riemannian manifold is uniformly bounded from below by some number k, if and only if the relative entropy functional is k convex on the vastness space. So what does this mean? I'm assuming that all of you have familiarity with the optimal transport distance. It also appeared in the talk by Giuseppe Savare a couple of days ago. So by minimizing the transport cost with cost function equal distance squared, you can produce a metric on the space of probability measures over an arbitrary metric space. In fact, so in particular over a Riemannian manifold, this metric is called W2. And if you are on a geodesic space, then this metric on the space of probability measures is also geodesics. It's also has geodesics. Now, if you are in a space which has geodesics and you have a functional defined on that space, you can say what it means for this functional to be convex. So it just means that along every geodesic parameterized with constant speed, the functional is convex. Now, in this case, as functional over the space of probability measure, we consider the Boltzmann entropy function. So integral of rho log rho, where rho is the density of your measure with respect to the volume measure, okay, which we take as reference, plus infinity if you are not absolutely continuous. Now, this is a function over a space of probability measures on which we are putting this vastest time W2 distance. So it makes sense to ask whether this functional has some convexity property. And it turns out that it is k-convex, so second derivative greater or equal than k, if and only if the Ricci curvature is bounded from below by k. Now, why this is interesting? Well, among other things, is because it characterizes a differential inequality, namely a lower bound on the Ricci, by means which are, say, I mean, no differential at all. So in the first line here, to speak about Ricci curvature, we need a smooth structure. In the second line over here, there are not any more derivatives. So as it often happens with good theorems, the thesis of the theorem became a definition. So, and this has been the idea of Lost, Sturm, and Villeneuve. So if it is given a generic metric measure space, XDM, well, we can say that this space has Ricci curvature bounded from below by K in some weak sense, provided the relative entropy functional, this time relative entropy is computed with respect to the given reference measure, is k-convex in the Varsenne space. Okay. So these spaces are called CD k-infinity. So CD stands for curvature dimension, and the first number over here is the lower bound on the curvature, and the second number is the upper bound on dimension. So in this case, there is no upper bound given, but in fact, so variants of this definition, by considering maybe not the relative entropy, but some other function, maybe not simply convexity, but some other more complicated form of convexity, it is also possible to introduce what are called CDKN spaces, where n here is a real number greater or equal than 1. And this offers a non-smooth counterpart of Riemannian manifold with Ricci greater than k and dimension less than n. Now, the reason for which there is this star over here is, has to do with the fine-tuning of the definitions, which came out all over the years. So the original definition by Sturm didn't have this star, but then it turned out that it was better to slightly modify it, and so a star appeared, and then for what we understand up to now, this star version is what is good to deal with, but anyway, I will not give the explicit definition of this thing. So for the purpose of the talk, it is sufficient to know that such a definition is possible by along the same ideas, so convexity type of entropy type functionals, and there is a sort of an analogous of Sturm-Vorenest result which characterizes CDKN. Now the role of Sturm-Vorenest theorem is in saying that this definition, this abstract definition, is fully compatible with the smooth case. So if your metric measure space happens to be a Riemannian manifold with the distance coming from the metric tensor and the volume measure, then having lower bound on the Ricci in the Lost Sturm-Vorenest sense is equivalent to having a standard lower bound on the Ricci. On the other hand, given the sort of the nature of the definition and sort of the spirit of what I said before, it is one would hope that this kind of class of spaces turns out to be closed with respect to measure Gronhausdorff convergence. And indeed it is, and here is the first time sort of the shadow of the George, if you wish, appears, in the sense that how Lost, Sturm, and Villeneuve proved that their condition is stable under measure Gronhausdorff convergence. Well, there is a very general result, which has nothing to do with lower Ricci bound, and which goes as follows. If you have a sequence of metric measure spaces converging in the measure Gronhausdorff sense to a limit space, well, then the relative entropy functional, the gamma converge to the relative entropy functional in the limit space. So what does this mean? Well, so measure Gronhausdorff convergence, as I said, means that we can embed all these spaces on a bigger space. So let's do this. Now, once this is done, I can read the relative entropy functional with respect, on the nth space as a functional over the space of probability measures on this bigger space Y. So and once I'm there, I can speak about gamma convergence with respect to weak convergence of measures. And it turns out that the relative entropies, indeed, they always gamma converge, regardless of any assumption, in a sense. And therefore, in particular, it is really easy to check that in a compact framework, at least, I mean, under some appropriate compactness conditions, K convexity or convexity of a function is a property which is stable under passage to limit. Okay, so this is really easy to check, and therefore coupling this result with the definition of CDK infinity, we get for free. I mean, they got for free that the notion is stable under this weak convergence. So far so good. The problem. The potential problem. I mean, let's say that depends on the tastes of everybody. But there is something which is worth to point out, is that Fizler structures are included in the analysis. So consider as a metric measure space. Well, it's not compact, but I mean, not a big deal. So consider RD with Lebesgue measure, and with the distance coming from a norm. And well, then there are these two sort of competing facts, which are both true. So the first is that this space has no negative Ricci curvature in the sense of Lostrum-Villani. Okay. Actually, it has no negative Ricci curvature and dimension bounded from O by D as one. I mean, we are on RT, this sort of is expected. But on the other hand, by results of Chigger-Colding, we also know that such a space cannot occur as a measure Gravasdorf limit of a sequence of Riemannian manifolds with Ricci curvature uniformly bounded from below and dimension bounded from above. Okay, so the structure of such limit spaces, called the rich limit spaces, or the limits of smooth Riemannian manifolds, has been sort of deeply investigated by Chigger and Colding in the late 90s. And one of the consequences of that result is that this norm space cannot appear as a limit of Riemannian manifold unless, of course, the norm comes from a scalar product, in which case, I mean, the guy is already a smooth Riemannian manifold with a negative curvature. And so, therefore, the question is, let me also add that Fizler manifolds, so Fizler manifolds Riemannian manifolds, but you put a norm on the tangent space rather than a scalar product. So in particular, D with a norm is a flat Fizler manifold, if you wish. Now, geometric properties of Fizler manifolds are typically very different from those of Riemannian manifolds. So if you run this business of studying this class of spaces in order to get new information about Riemannian manifolds with lower Ricci curvature bound, well, then this class of spaces is in some sense too big because it contains inside also things for which those geometric properties are really not true. So this motivates, I mean, sort of the quest for finding maybe a more restrictive notion, which is still stable under this weak convergence, and rules out Fizler geometries. And here, is some observation. So how do we do this? First of all, on a Fizler manifold, so how can we recognize Riemannian manifolds within the framework of Fizler manifolds? Well, there are various ways. So one of these is the following, is to look at the subwave space W12, and so real valued subwave functions, and check whether this is Hilbert or not. If this is Hilbert, then the manifold is indeed Riemannian. Or we can look at the Laplacian and check whether it is linear. And it is linear if and only if the manifold is Riemannian. So there are spaces where the Laplacian is nonlinear in particular. So as soon as you are on a Fizler world as opposed to Riemannian one. Coupled with this observation, so in particular concerning the heat flow, we also know that at least in the smooth case, the heat flow can be seen as gradient flow. In particular, it can be seen as gradient flow of the Dirichlet energy in the space L2. So that's sort of classical result. And more recently, although now it's almost 20 years ago, Jordan, Kinderer, and Otto realized that if you consider the gradient flow of the relative entropy function with respect to the same vastness and distance that we considered before, then the evolution turns out to be once again the heat flow. So we do have these two very different approaches and to the heat flow as gradient flow. And now this paper by John Kinder and Otto had a tremendous impact in the community and motivated the study of gradient flows in the Varsenet space, in different functional, different underlying spaces. And among the various generalizations, I want to point out a paper by Otto and Sturm in 2009. So they show that the gradient flow, the relative entropy with respect to the Varsenet distance, is the heat flow even in the Fiesler setting. So even in a situation where the heat flow is not linear, still this interpretation of the heat flow as gradient flow of the relative entropy is true. Now,
there is a natural thing to try to do now. So why don't we restrict to the case to CD spaces where the heat flow is linear? Okay.
Of course, I mean, there is something to say here, so we need to discuss what is the heat flow and show that this is stable. And this has been the subject of a series of papers where sort of the conclusion of the story came in a series of papers of Ambrosio Savarin and myself a few years ago. And let me introduce at least few of the concepts that underline this sort of analysis. One thing is the following. The relative entropy functional we already discussed, the vastness and distance we already discussed. But if we want to also look to the other point of view on the heat flow, so namely the gradient flow of the Dirichlet energy, I need to define what it is a Dirichlet energy in metric measure spaces. And so this is something which in spirit is very close to what Wenger was saying yesterday. So he was considering Sobre functions from a Euclidean domain into a target, maybe ugly metric space. Now here the situation is a bit reversed. So here the source space is an abstract space, so XDM, and the target space is always R. I'm interested in considering what are Sobre functions, real valued Sobre functions defined on a metric measure space. Because then by considering the gradient flow of the Dirichlet energy in L2, we'll have a reasonable definition of heat flow. Now, there is a long story here. So the first papers in this direction have been by Yagwash 20 years ago, and then Shigeresh and Mugaliga, more or less at the same time, they produced, other definitions, and more recently, Ambrosio Savarin and myself sort of revised all of this. So it turns out that basically, with the exception of the first paper of Yagwash, all other definitions are equivalent, one to each other. And let me show you one of these possible definitions. So first of all, one defines the local Lipschitz constant of a real valued function. So you just look at the Lim-sum of the incremental ratio in here. And then you define the Chigel energy functional as you take for a generic function in L2, you look for all sequences of Lipschitz functions Fn which converge to F in L2, and we do the infimum over all these sequences of the diminf of the integral of this Lipschitz constant squared. Now, it is an easy exercise to check that if the space is RD with the Euclidean structure, then this definition reproduces the standard definition of Dirichlet energy. Now, yet we call this functional Chigel energy because, in general, this functional is not a quadratic form, so it is not a Dirichlet form, this functional. So calling it Dirichlet energy, could have been a source of confusion. And given that Chigel has been the first to define this sort of objects by relaxation means, which was this name. And then if you have this, the replacement for the Dirichlet energy, then the Sobre space, it will be just the set of functions with finite energy. And there's a natural norm to put on this space. And this turns out to be always a Banach space. So maybe not Hilbert, but always Banach. The fact that it is not Hilbert, should be of no surprise, given that we already said that on Fiesler words, this is not Hilbert. So far, so good. And one last thing that is worth to mention concerning the structure of Sobre functions on metric measure spaces is that they come with a natural notion of what it is the modulus of the distributional differential. And this Chigel energy functional admits a realization as integral functional, familiar, so the integral of
grad f squared for some notion of modulus of grad, and how do you define this guy? Well, basically you can check that if you take an optimal sequence of Lipschitz functions, so optimal in the definition of Cheeger energy, and you look at their local Lipschitz constants, well then these strongly to converge to something, and the limit is independent of the sequence. So that limit guy, you call it a minimal weak upper gradient. Now, with this said, let me sort of run straight to the conclusion with this relevant theorem concerning the behavior of the heat flow. And the theorem morally says that under a lower Ricci bound, these two points of view that I previously described on the heat flow, they always coincide. And in fact, we can also sort of discuss how much this Ricci bound is needed, but I don't want to enter into the details. So in which sense they coincide, because there are gradient flows on different spaces? Well, and they coincide whenever it is possible to compare them, they provide the same evolution. So which means that if you have a probability measure which is absolutely continuous with density in L2, then I can consider on one side the gradient flow of the relative entropy functional in the respect to the varsity and distance starting from U. On the other side, I can consider the evolution of densities in terms of gradient flows of this Cheeger energy function in L2. Well, then it turns out that mu t is equal to ftm for every positive t. So whenever it is possible to compare the two flows, they coincide. Now, here there are a lot of things which I'm hiding, but at least one of these I want to make sort of this evident. So while to define what it is a gradient flow of this Cheeger energy functional, it is sufficient to deal with the theory of gradient flows in Hilbert spaces or flows of maximal monotone operators as developed, for instance, by Blazis, because this Cheeger energy function might be not a quadratic form, but is always convex and lower semi-continuous. On the other hand, even just to define what it is a W2 gradient flow of this relative entropy functional, quite a lot of work is needed. And here the influence of the Georgi has been crucial, so he has been the first to propose what it means for a curve to be a gradient flow in a very abstract metric setting, and also provided the basis of the first existence results in this regard. And this is a subject which has been then sort of retaken and reworked by Ambrosio Savarin and myself, and within the resulting theory, I mean, it is possible to show that at least so this guy is well defined. There exists a notion of gradient flow, and it turns out to be unique in this setting. Okay, so I don't want to say more, sort of otherwise, I mean, I speak only of this, but I mean, the Georgi here has been crucial. So let's take this as given. So, and once we know that the heat flow is sort of is well defined, now there is a very natural thing to do. So, is to restrict to the case of to this class of spaces where the heat flow is linear, which according to this result, so heat flow linear. So the heat flow is the gradient flow of the Cheeger energy. So this is the same as to say that I'm restricting to the class of spaces which are CDK infinity and W12 is Hilbert, okay? And this identification result, in some sense, implies that this condition is stable under measure Gravois-Dorff convergence. So what it turns out is that this heat flow is stable under measure Gravois-Dorff convergence. And why it is? Because it can be seen as gradient flow of a K-convex function. And gradient flows of K-convex functionals pass to the limit under gamma convergence. So that's the basic idea. So this is an observation firstly made by Sandier and Serfati, and later on sort of retaken by myself. So now we found a restriction. So we ruled out physical geometries. So now we have a stable notion under weak convergence. Now, of course. Now we have restricted our class of spaces, so now we expect to, I mean, be able to do something on this space, which perhaps was not doable on general CDK infinity spaces. And let me point out that so that you can start building a calculus, a quite efficient one in some sense, even in this abstract setting, as soon as W12 is Hilbert, because the starting point is that by polarization, so so for some of the functions, this object modulus of the f was defined, as I was saying before, and now you can try to polarize this object, and if the space is Hilbert, it turns out there's a little bit of work to do, but it turns out that this grad f grad g, which I'm defining in here, without really telling you which grad f or grad g, just the scalar product, is well defined, and is bilinear. Okay. So for those of you with familiarity with the context of Dirichlet forms, so if W12 is Hilbert, then the Cheeger energy is a Dirichlet form, and this grad f grad g is nothing but the carré du champ, so the gamma operator associated to the Dirichlet form. So different names for the same kind of object. And once you have grad f grad g, you can integrate by parts and also define the Laplacian. So you can say, for instance, that a function f has Laplacian in L2, if there is a Laplacian such that the integration by parts work. Okay, and this is a linear operator, densely defined, okay. The almost last result that I want to mention concerning the structure of general RCD spaces is that there is Bokken inequality. Okay, now so this inequality on Riemannian manifolds completely characterizes a lower bound by K on the Ricci curvature. In fact, to some extent, people working in geometric analysis often think to a lower bound on the Ricci curvature by means of this Bokken inequality. So knowing that this inequality is true. Let me point out that in this inequality, there are, in some sense, three derivatives. So whatever you count them, either on the left or on the right, there are sort of three derivatives. And it is quite surprising that you can give a meaning to this inequality even in these abstract metric measure spaces, at least if you sort of integrate by parts, in some sense. So if you multiply both sides by g, you imagine to do this, and integrate, and then integrate by parts. So this Bokken inequality holds in the sense that for f and g in the appropriate function spaces, so such that these integrals all make sense, this inequality is true. And part of the point here is that there are many f's and g's with have a Laplacian, with Laplacian in W12, so that this guy makes sense, and g which is L infinity in the domain of the Laplacian, non-negative, and with Laplacian in L infinity, so that this also makes sense, and so on and so forth. This result provides a sort of, in some sense, an Eulerian counterpart to the Losthoorn-Villani-Lagrangian point of view on lower Ricci bounds. And it turns out that under appropriate conditions, also the converse inequality holds. So this is a rather technical result, but which I want to point out because it is useful, I think, in applications. So you can say, I have a space where, this Bokken inequality holds in the same weak sense that was discussed in the previous slide. Can I deduce that this space is RCD K infinity? I mean, if my space was a Riemannian manifold, the answer would be yes, because as I told you, Bokken inequality characterizes lower Ricci curvature bounds. So in non-smooth spaces, things are a bit harder, but essentially the answer is yes, provided there is the space as an intrinsic an intrinsic regularity property, which in some sense allows to deduce metric informations out of subtle ones. So a crucial assumption that you need to add on top of Bokken inequality in order to be sure, to be able to integrate this inequality and get back the notion of RCD K infinity space, is that whenever you have a subtle function whose minimum weak upper gradient is less or equal than one everywhere, then this function must have a one Lipschitz representative. So up to changing the function a negligible Borel set, you get a one Lipschitz function. Now, this property is quite restrictive. So if you have familiarity with, say, the setting of spaces with doubling and Poincaré, well, doubling and Poincaré is not enough to get this property. So this is really a very rigid property of the space. And once the setup of the theory is done, in some sense, one can extend it to include also finite dimensional spaces, which in terms of Bokken inequality are identified by the presence of this additional positive term in the right-hand side. So previously we were dealing morally with n equal infinity, so here is a denominator, so we didn't see this term, but if n is finite, we are adding something positive on the right-hand side, so this inequality sort of is more strict. And there is a complete duality between this Bokner inequality, the previous set of assumptions, and the curvature bounds in the sense of Lotzer-Mobiliani. So one of the reasons I'm pointing out this result and the previous one is that it gives a way of speaking about lower Ricci bounds, weak lower Ricci bound, without mentioning optimal transport at all. So this is a complete Eulerian description. And in particular, it is useful in applications where you have some space which, okay, it's not smooth, but maybe almost smooth. You can imagine some manifold with singularities, some orbifolds, some varifolds, and this sort of spaces, it is typically easier to deal with differential calculus rather than with geodesics in the optimal transport sense between probability measures, which are always a bit sort of hard to deal with. Okay. With that said, so a few words about some geometric properties, so selected geometric properties of these spaces. So let me tell that, so this subject, as I was saying, is undergoing a sort of an exponential growth. So the definition of RCD came in 2011. So the first geometric results have been obtained in 2012. And we are now in September, and there's already, a few non-trivial papers which came out in these regards. So I don't want you, to scan the list. This was just to, present the variety of results. This list is absolutely non-exhaustive, and absolutely only speaks about geometric properties. So I'm leaving out all the results concerning analysis on this space. So for instance, Liao inequality or Lipschitz regularity of harmonic functions, and many other things which would be worth to saying, but I have to make some selection. So let me just describe three of these results, just because I think that they are interesting in their own, and they are somehow linked one to each other. And in the very end, if we are able to go through the very end, we will also learn something new about smooth Riemannian manifolds by the study of these abstract spaces. So providing one example of something that we can gain following this sort of class of ideas. So what is the splitting theorem? So the splitting theorem is a rigidity statement. It has a long story. So the first versions in dimension 2 were proved by Combossen almost 100 years ago. Now, what is usually referred to as splitting theorem is the result by Chigger and Gromol. And the result goes as follows. So, Chigger and Gromol is this. So, you have a Riemannian manifold with non-negative Ricci, which contains a straight line. So there is really an isometric bending of R into this manifold. Well, then this manifold splits. So this line is a factor in some sense. Our manifold M is isometric to another manifold times R. I guess that the best way to see this result, if you've never seen it before, is thinking in dimension 2. So in dimension 2, you have a surface with non-negative Ricci, which means non-negative curvature, because in dimension 2, all the curvature coincide, and which contains a line. Well, then your surface is either the cylinder or the plane, nothing else, because it must factor off a line, so it must be a line across a one-dimensional manifold, and now there are not so many one-dimensional manifolds. So that completely characterizes the splitting in dimension 2. And now the point is that the splitting is valid even in this class of spaces with the appropriate modification of the definition. So now Riemannian manifold with non-negative Ricci becomes RCD star 0n. What is a line? Well, this is an isometric bending of R. So this is it. So something an helicoidal line on a cylinder would not work, because that would be a locally minimizing geodesic, but would not be minimizing for any couple, of ST. It would be minimizing only for S and T, which are close. And this is not good for the splitting. And if this is the case, well, then our space is isomorphic to a protospace of another space X prime cross R, where the distance is the one coming from Pythagoras' theorem, in some sense. So let me see. So this statement is dramatically false without the R. So the R, well, I didn't say, the R stands for Riemannian. So Riemannian curvature dimension is also to emphasize that we sort of ruled out physical geometries. And on CD spaces, this is very false. Because if you take R2 with the distance coming from a norm, which is not coming from a scalar product, well, then this space has a lot of straight lines, of course, but it does not split because the distance does not have this product structure. Okay, so this really, in some sense, is something that can be true only on RCD spaces. So no words on the proof, except that in some sense there has been not a huge breakthrough in the way the splitting is proved. So, well, I don't want to trivialize my own work too much, but if I had to condensate in a few lines, I mean, what are literally hundreds of pages, I would say that, so what I did, I went through the paper by Chigar and Gromol and sort of carefully checked whenever any of the regularity statements that they were using was truly necessary or not. And so somehow lowering the various regularity requirements. And on the other hand, building on the abstract setting, calculus tools that allowed sort of to mimic the tools available in the Riemannian setting. So we've already seen the Laplacian integration by parts, Buchner inequality. Then things can go on. You can speak about measure value Laplacian, maximum principle, Laplacian comparison estimates, and so forth and so forth. And there will be a moment in which sort of the two touch. So you have a calculus sufficiently powerful to sort of handle the result, and then you get the proof in some sense. So very shortly saying, but this is really hundreds of pages. So let me skip this remark and perhaps discuss a little bit this beautiful result by Christian Ketterer, which is in some sense the analogous of the splitting for positive Ricci curvature. So if the Ricci curvature is positive, on a Riemannian manifold, we know that a manifold with a positive Ricci curvature must have a finite diameter. This is the so-called Bonne-Meyer's inequality, okay? And the maxima diameter theorem is a theorem concerning what happens if that diameter is reached. So let's consider a space which is, say, RCD n minus 1, n. So this is a dimension at most n and curvature at least n minus 1. So the prototype of the space is Sn, okay? A prototype. So Sn has diameter pi, because two distances, two opposite points have distance pi. And in general, RCD star n minus 1 n spaces have diameter less than pi, less or equal than pi. But if the space has diameter pi, well, then our space is a spherical suspension over another space. And so what is a spherical suspension? Well, I think that the thing is most is best understood via an example. So pick Sn and cut a lot of parallel slices of Sn along one given fixed hyperplane. And then what you see is a lot of Sn minus 1, whose diameter sort of, increases and then decreases along this section. Well, this means that Sn is a spherical suspension of Sn minus 1. So a spherical suspension, you pick a lot of copies of your space, you put one close to the other with appropriate scaling factors. So this is the non-smooth variant of Chang theorem. So in the smooth case, this was already known, and also in the case of limits of Riemannian manifolds. But let me point out, so one thing that I want to say is how Ketterer proved this, and what is has to do, what is the key lemma that he proved? So basically, he proved a statement concerning cones. So a cone is another sort of basic geometric construction. A cone is, an example. So the cone over Sn is Rn plus 1. So the cone is, you pick your space and you sort of multiply it by a half line, but then you sort of rescale the diameter of your space sort of linearly with your half line sort of to get a cone. So a cone over a smallest circle as 1 is really what we think as a cone. A cone over an S1 of diameter 1, it comes out to be really, say R2. And what it proves is that if you start from a space which is RCD n minus 1 n, and you build a cone, then you get a space which is RCD 0 n plus 1, and vice versa. So you can read this in this way. So if you start with a space which is more curved than Sn, then the resulting cone is more curved than Rn plus 1. And the way he proved this is essentially by means of Eulerian calculus. So what he really did was he looked to Buchner inequality and proved that the Buchner inequality in the base space and in the product, they are related by sort of the same relation that are true in the smooth world. But the hard part here, this was really a surprise to me when he came out with this result, because the hard part is dealing with the vertex. And let me describe this. So why this is crucial? Because take S1 and take the cone over S1. Now, if you take S1 with a small diameter, the resulting cone will have a sort of a curvature plus infinity in the vertex in some sense, and then will be flat outside. If you take S1 with diameter pi, then the cone is really R2. But if you take the cone over an S1 of diameter bigger than pi, then you obtain a structure which, in some sense, has infinite negative curvature in the vertex. Okay? Now, regardless of the diameter of S1, if you take out the vertex from this cone, what you obtain is a flat space, because there is nothing going on over there. So Bochner inequality, in some sense, outside the vertex is true regardless of the diameter. However, so if you want to obtain some lower Ricci curvature bound, it means that you must recognize, in some sense, via the study of the Laplacian and the spectrum in particular, the diameter of the base space, which cannot exceed pi. So Ketterer was able to go through this. And once you have this, why you get the spherical suspension theorem? Sorry, the maxima diameter theorem. Well, because you start with your space, which has diameter pi, so there are these two points at distance pi. You build a cone on top of it, and what turns out is that the two half lines from the vertex to these two points at distance pi, they join to form a line. Okay, so the fact that the distance is pi, so these two half lines sort of get aligned. And now you have an RCD 0 n plus 1 space with a line. So this splits. And the fact that this space splits and that the original space was the sort of sphere of radius 1 in this cone really gives you this spherical suspension result that is in Ketterer's result. Now let me sort of conclude with one last important geometric/analytic property of Riemannian manifolds with positive Ricci curvature. So let's say again up to scaling. So let's say that we have a Riemannian manifold of dimension n, a Ricci curvature bounded from below by n minus 1. And then in this setting we have the Levi-Gromov isoperimetric inequality, which tells us that essentially the isoperimetric profile of such a manifold is always sort of worse than the one of Sn. So you pick any set, any Borel set, well, say smooth. I don't want to discuss too much what this guy. So say a smooth set within M, and you look at the measure of its boundary. You normalize it by the measure of M. Well, this is always greater or equal than the ratio, the analogous ratio done on Sn, which is our sort of reference model space for this sort of curvature bound and dimension bound, where B is the spherical cup with the same measure as our set E. Okay. So this is the Levi-Gromov isoperimetric inequality. And more of this inequality also comes with the rigidity case. So if you have equality for some non-trivial set E, so we measure which is strictly between 0 and the maximum 1, then the manifold is really Sn. Okay? It's not just a spherical cup, it's really Sn. Okay? So you get a global information out of this information. And recently, Cavaletti and Mondino have been able to prove this result in the setting of RCD spaces, also with the rigidity part. So what they used as a replacement for measure of the boundary of a set has been the outer Minkowski content, which is sort of perfectly defined definable object on abstract metric measure structure. So you have a set E, you take the epsilon neighborhood, you look at its measure, you subtract the measure of E, you divide by epsilon, and then you take the limit when epsilon goes to 0. You know if the limit exists, so well, you pick the limit, for instance. And then what they proved is that if you start with a space which is RCD star n minus 1 n, normalized, say, just to avoid those fractions which were in the previous slide, well then this outer Minkowski content of any set E is bounded from below by a function of the measure of E, which is the same function which was appearing in the Levi-Gromov isoperimetric inequality, and they have the rigidity case. And the rigidity case is so if equality holds for some set, well then the space, well in this smooth case was a sphere. Now this the best you can say is that it's a spherical suspension. So there are There are examples of spherical suspension for which equality holds, so this is really the best you can say. So 3 minutes, or I'm already out of time? 5, okay, great, thanks. Because there is that, so I want to say one thing about the proof, because this is really, something which is works like magic. And the basic idea is to reduce the problem of the isoperimetric inequality to a one-dimensional problem. And in 1D, you can run the computation. And this, in the case of smooth Riemannian manifold, is known as a sort of needle decomposition, which they were able to run in abstract metric measure spaces. So here is the point. The key lemma is this. You're given space, space is given, and then you are also given two probability densities. Well, then the point is that you can disintegrate the reference measure M into a family of measures, so say M alpha, such that, so each of these is concentrated on some geodesic, gamma alpha, so it's really like you have your space and you're tracing a lot of geodesics on it, and then you sort of decompose or disintegrate the measure with respect to this family of geodesics. And in such that two non-trivial things are both true at the same time. So the first is that if you look at this geodesic with the distance coming from the ambient space and the measure M alpha, so as a metric measure space per se, this has Ricci curvature bounded from below by K and dimension bounded from above by N in the sense of this RCDK and space. So first thing. And second thing, rho zero and rho one are also probability densities on each or almost each of these geodesics. Now, if you're able to do this, by the way, so how do they do this? Well, for some reason, you call into play the L1 optimal transportation distance, so not the L2, which is the one that you use to define lower Ricci bound. You call into play the L1 transportation distance, and some magic cancellation occurs in some sense, and these sort of, I don't really want to get into the details, but. Just to emphasize that using L1 distance, L1 transport distance in here allows to produce such a structure. And once you have this, essentially, your isoperimetric inequality is essentially proved, because then you apply this result to rho zero, which is the normalized measure on E, and rho one, which is on your set E, and rho one, which is the normalized measure of the complement. And then essentially these two lines over here allow you to reduce the problem of isoperimetric inequality to a 1D problem where you can run the computation. And you can also check that if equality holds, well then one of these spaces, well actually almost all of these spaces, must have really diameter pi. And so Ketterer result comes into play and you get a spherical suspension. Okay. Now this sort of strategy has been inspired by some work of Klartag in the smooth setting, and also of Emanuel Milman, I should add, and this metric construction, this kind of okay, bizarre, I would say, metric construction has its roots in works by Bianchini and Cavalletti. So my time is over. Let me add just one last thing. So because once you have this rigidity statement, you can hope for an almost rigidity statement. So now you can wonder whether the following result is true. So say that N is given and epsilon is given. Well, maybe you would like to find a delta such that if the assumptions in Cavalletti-Mondino theorem are almost satisfied up to a delta, I forgot a star here, I apologize. So your space is RCD, well, not really N minus one N, but N minus one minus delta N plus delta, so almost that. And you have a set, we'll say half of the mass, and for which the almost the optimality in the isoperimetric inequality holds. Then you could ask yourself, well, must this space be close to a spherical suspension? I mean, if delta is zero over here, if you have a space which satisfies this with delta equals zero, then it is a spherical suspension. This is Cavalletti-Mondino. But I could say, so if the assumptions are almost satisfied, can I deduce that the sort of the thesis of Cavalletti-Mondino is almost satisfied? So is this the space epsilon close to some spherical suspension? And the answer is yes. And in some sense, this comes from the link between this outer Minkowski content used in the analysis of Cavalletti-Mondino and the total variation of characteristic functions and the theory of BV functions on metric measure spaces, and the non-trivial fact that a sort of total variation energy, total variation norms is essentially under a lower Ricci bound, most co-converge, most pass to limit in the sense of of Moscow. So all of this has been done by essentially Ambrosio and co-authors. So once you have this, basically by trivial compactness reasons, you get this almost rigid result. So because you argue like this. So if this was not true, then I could find a sequence of spaces where with delta n which goes to zero, which are all far from some spherical suspension. But now these spaces by essentially Gromov precompactness result must converge to a limit space. And these sets which are almost satisfying the isoperimetric inequality will pass to the limit and produce a set in the limit for which the inequality is actually an equality. So in the limit space you will have a set for which the equality the isoperimetric inequality holds. But then by Cavalletti-Mondino this must be a spherical suspension. So this means that our approximating sequence was getting close to a spherical suspension. So this kind of argument is, in some sense, one at least of the raison d'etre of the business of making analysis on non-smooth spaces. So let me underline that this was absolutely not known in the Riemannian setting. So you can replace this XDM with Riemannian manifold with these bounds on the Ricci, and you could ask this question, and this question was dramatically not known. So this is one of the first non-trivial results, I would say. For which we learn something new about the smooth world by compactness arguments based on analysis on the non-smooth world. So perhaps I shall stop here. There are one last slide, but let me conclude here. So thank you very much for your attention. Could be, sorry? Okay, very good question. So the best honest answer is that in general, I have no idea. And honestly, I think that nobody really does, in the sense that we are not really that good in putting our hands on these spaces that, I mean, to be able to really, I mean, desingularize them. And geometric evolutions, the non-smooth setting, is hard, actually harder than the one on the smooth setting. So I was discussing with Sturm about this problem, and actually he made an interesting remark. So maybe in the general answer maybe will be very far, but there is the chance that for RCD K3 spaces, maybe that in this case we can be able to obtain something, basically because we might hope to have a Ricci flow in dimension less or equal than 3. And why do we might be able to do this? Because there are results granting sort of lower bounds on the existence time for Ricci flow in dimension 3, which only require lower Ricci bounds. So no other bounds. So maybe you can try to sort of hope that the same sort of result is true for whatever Ricci flow is in the non-smooth setting, but maybe in dimension less or equal than 3, you can get something, and then maybe you can cross your finger and hope that your Ricci flow desingularizes in any way the space. But besides this, which is a remark by Sturm, I really have no idea. So the question is very interesting, but we don't know.
More questions?
If there is
a synthetic notion,
not that I'm aware of, and I'd like very much. So the question was for those of you who didn't hear was so much like I discussed a synthetic notion of lower Ricci bound. The question was whether there is a synthetic notion for at least non-negative scalar curvature, and I'd love to, and I'd love to know. But as far as I know, there's nothing like this. So I mean, the reason I presented in the very first slide this missing point was really because, I mean, sort of to advertise these things. So if anybody has any idea in this direction, I mean, that would be really an interesting line of research to investigate. But no, I don't.
Thanks again.